coastal air force under Air Marshal Lloyd. Day and night fighters, these, protecting ports and convoys. And finally, the tactical air force, a new conception of air power developed by the British in the Middle East. All fighters and attack bombers, British and American, were placed under one command so that we could strike with the full force of our flying artillery when and where it would do the most good. Air Marshal Cunningham in command of this group and General Alexander in command of all ground forces lived and worked side by side in a tent camp in the Tunisian mountains. Theirs was a complete partnership, and in it lay the pattern of ultimate victory. By the middle of March, the stage was set. The first move was up to Air Marshal Cunningham. In a continuous 24-hour assault, the Mareth fortifications were pounded from the air. Then General Alexander gave the signal for the piston to begin its upward stroke.
Montgomery, looking ahead, had planned the Mareth battle 3 months before. He would strike after a barrage and in moonlight, as at El Alamein. But simultaneously, he would begin an outflanking movement on the left. The frontal blow had to cross a gorge, the Wadi Zigzag, and create a bridgehead under cover of which tanks and artillery could cross the Wadi before the enemy's counterattack in force could be met. 3 days before the attack, it rained heavily. Morning, our men were holding on like bulldogs. Only four tanks had got across, but with these and their own arms, our infantry kept the bridgehead intact. The enemy, fearing another El Alamein, now withdrew armor from other sectors and threw it in. Whilst this battle raged, our outflanking left hook by General Freiberg and his New Zealanders, reinforced by the 1st Armored Division, was racing across 150 miles of desert towards El Hama. The blow was now struck by 50,000 men on the ground and by bombers, fighters and tank busters from the air. The Germans, pinned down by the Northumbrians at Mareth, moved their armor too late. The New Zealanders, thenceforth to be known as the Left Hookers, drove through.
line had been turned. The piston was on the move. Its speed made possible by the feats in road building of the South African engineers. Air and naval forces shelled and bombed all along the seawall. Our fighters struck at their transport planes, still pouring men in through the intake valve, knocking them out of the sky by the hundreds. British First Army was a constant threat in the north, while in the center the French had attacked at Pichon, and further south the Americans had broken through to El Guitar and McNassie, thus enforcing constant pressure all along the land wall of the cylinder. April 7th, and American patrols of light tanks striking eastward met patrols of the British 8th Army advancing northward.
We got quite a bang out of meeting these guys. 2,000 miles they'd come, fighting all the way. Yes, sir, we got a real bang out of it. These are the guys that broke the back of the Africa Corps.
Still, the piston pushed relentlessly on. April the 10th, Sfax fell. April the 12th, Sousse. And on April the 20th, after exactly 30 days of fighting in pursuit, the 8th Army had driven the enemy into the hills beyond Enfidaville. And in its wake was a great homecoming.
What got me was watching those villagers coming back, mostly on little donkeys piled up with so much stuff you'd wonder how they carried it. Reminded me of the Bible somehow, you know, the donkeys and the hills behind and these folks trekking home. There was one old chap spoke a bit of English and he comes up to me and old Joe McAdams and he says, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. And then he started shaking hands with us. I thought he was never going to let go. And as we watched him going down the hill, Joe says to me, he says, you know, George, I had a buddy killed the other day and I was pretty sore about it. But now all these poor devils coming home gives the whole thing a kind of a meaning. Well, then when we went down to the village, it was just the same down there. Little Jewish boys taking off the yellow stars they'd been made to wear as if they was lepers. And then our army doctors attending to the women and the youngsters, just as if they was on the panel back home. I certainly felt less browned off. I certainly did.